So the simplest situation is that we solve this equation. In this case, we just replace x by omega t at time t at each given time, and then phi is omega capital T, okay, omega of capital T. This is the most simple situation. And then if we want to solve the heat equation for whole depends on path, like U is like UT omega, and with T depends on T, and with U depends on T, and the whole path from zero to small t. This is the terminal condition is U capital T is phi. Phi is given path function. It's a function of path. It's a given function of path, and defining like this. Of course, after having the whole situation, it will be some complete. A very interesting phenomena, but we began from a sample case where we just solve phi, which is the so-called finite dimensional function, which is of this form, which T1, Tn is this form, okay? And we just want to solve this PDE with a terminal condition like this. In this case, we just need to solve for each, we want to solve the function path in the space of a finite dimensional function space. So for each U, there exists the time partition T0 to T n, which is capital N, such that the function we have, and we have C12 function. C12 means the function U, which is parameterized by x1, xk, minus 1, in each time tk, tk minus 1, tk, which is function of t and x. And So it's just a smooth function, smooth enough for our purpose. And then the ut omega is like this. In each time interval, it is like we parameterized by t1, tk minus 1 of tx. So it's like this, in whole. Then if we define this and solve this equation, and in each time, in first time, in this time, we just solve just its function of t and x, then of course then we can solve this, but we need the link condition. We can guarantee that this UTX is continuous in T. Otherwise, it's not continuous. It's continuous in T. So we have this condition. And with this condition, we can define the partial derivatives, the state derivatives, for x dx and dx square of space derivatives. So we define this, and then after the problem is to find such kind of function which solve the PD, okay, which solve this PD. So here is omega T1 to Tn. So phi is given, phi.
As you think about omega, it's a
It's not yet a Brownian motion. Now is a path of a continuous path. Of course, you can think about the Brownian motion. You don't need for the moment. Okay, for the moment you don't need. You just think it's a continuous path, and I solve this equation. For the moment, there are no probability. Okay, there are no probability. I just try to solve this heat equation, and the heat equation have terminal condition, and I solve this interval by interval, backwardly, from. So this is so this of course for each interval the problem is well posed, so I can. Which this one? So I also define the derivative, okay? The derivative is defined to, for example, dt. It's just you think this is parametrized by t1, t2. It's fixed. You just derivative by t, by small t. And for x, you just derivative for x. So this is a function, a real function. It's a real function which is depends on x, on this. Okay, so it's well defined. It's well defined function. Okay. So the for example, for the first interval, for the last interval, t. From tn minus 1 to tn, we just fix this and solve this x. So you give a solution of x, and so you just solve du x1 xn minus 1 tx plus du. The same thing, d square u x x, 1 over 2 equal to 0, and give capital T x1 xn minus 1 capital T x equal phi x1 xn minus 1. This is the x. This is the, we just think which is a function of x, okay? So it's a function of x and the t in each interval. Okay? We will come to nonlinear case. This is just the for linear case. In linear case, the reason is you can define this, and you have already your Brownian motion definition hidden behind. Okay, so this is of course we will talk about the nonlinear Brownian motion, and this equation is well defined, and you have a unique solution for this equation, which is the function is a finite. Finite dimensional function. And of course, when I solve this equation, I know that if I make phi equal to c constant, then it's identically equal to c. It's just because we solve it, each time we solve a real PDE, this is zero. If you put u equal to c, this is zero, then you satisfy all conditions. So it's equal to c. And also, we know that for each h between 0 capital T, if I want to solve this one, and it's the same thing that I solve this one, OK? This one is the omega t plus h minus omega t. It's the same thing. Why? Because time capital T, T plus H, it's just keeping constant. It's is just keeping constant because you have no x, no omega t here. Omega is does not contain omega t, so we t here, and from here we have ut omega is phi t uh sorry t plus h is t is t plus h u t plus h omega is nothing but u t plus h omega, which is depends on t plus it depends on omega t plus h, which is and which depends also on omega t, which is fixed. This is a parameter. So I solve this by putting this as x. I solve this equation from this, from t to t, to here, which is equivalent to telling me that I solve the same thing beginning from ht and t to zero. So I solve this is the same thing like solving this. So this gives us stable. And also by the same order, if I solve the equation by first putting t here and t plus h minus t here, and then it's equivalent that I first solve the equation putting psi is omega of t here, and solving this t time 0, 0, and it's the same thing. It's the same thing that and then after I solve this is equivalent to first solve this one and then solve this one. And first put this as a parameter. So omega t is a parameter. I put parameter here. First solve this and then continuously solve the second one. So this this is by definition. It's easy to be checked, which is true. And then after this, after defining this, then I can define a operator which maps all finite dimensional function phi of omega 1, omega 2, omega t1, omega t2, omega tn form to define a number, to assign this by a number which is 0 and omega 0. Okay, so I assign a number. It's just because when I come back to the time t0, so there are, it depends no more on the path because it's 0. Okay, it's 0. There are no more paths. So it's become a number, and I define this number as functional. So this expectation, so I define a functional, okay? I define a function. This functional is defined on the function of phi. But all function, all such, all function.
This is the way you're defining the measurement through this
function. Yeah. Yeah, it's a Wiener number. It's just defined.
But why define it like this? It's so complicated. I don't understand. Why? Of course, it's equivalent to this.
No, why do we do it? No, we try to do it, and by and then we will give a non-trivial things after. Okay. After it's just for the moment it's just a definition, and this definition give a number, and with this number we know that we can send all such kind of function to a number which is a linear function, because the equation is linear and it's linearly depends on the terminal condition. Okay, so this is for the moment is. It's like this. And this functional sends all these functions to R such that this is positive and it is positive. If it's the C is C, then it is C, it's a constant. And also we can prove that if converges downstairs, downwardly, then phi I, if phi converges downwardly, then this is also converges downwardly. Okay? So this we can immediately apply Daniel Stone theorem to prove that there exists a unique probability measure UP which defined on omega and the Borel algebra of omega such that in fact, this E phi omega probability measure is an integral. Okay. So it's immediately give me integral. And we also tell us that in fact this BT omega, so we define BT omega like omega t, which is the so-called canonical process. Okay, we define this, and we already proved that when we take this e, then this does not depend on t, on h. It's this the e phi does not depend on h. Bt plus h minus h does not depend on h. And we also telling that bt plus bh plus t minus bt is independent of all the h1, h2, which is smaller than h. So this is the function, the equation telling us about this, and then we can be sure that P is a Wiener process. So this is a way to telling us that we can come from here directly to nonlinear situation, which is in this case. So how we can define nonlinear PDE for the nonlinear PDE, we can also define this. We just change this second order nonlinear, and we just chose the typical situation where g omega is a sublinear function, which is a sublinear function as. Just like this sublinear function, and if upper sigma equal to lower sigma, then it's just the line It's just the situation we have treated. Okay, and then for this, we also can solve this PDE. We solve this past PDE. Once we can solve this PDE, then we can solve past PDE. Okay, the past PDE and this PDE have so we can solve this PDE. This PDE gives us a C1-2 solution, and we can use this to solve the past PDE. So the derivative is the same. And then we solve this, and we can then introduce sublinear functional. A sublinear functional is also defined by you solve all, and at time zero, they give me a number. So this gives a sublinear functional with value in R, and I know that because this equation satisfies the so-called comparison theory, I have this. If phi is bigger than psi, I have this. If it's a constant, because if this is zero, this is zero is equal to zero. So this is keeping constant, and also I have the downward continuity. And then after this, we can still use Daniell-Stone theorem and the Hamm-Banach theorem to prove that, in fact, there exists a family of probability measure which is including the Wiener measure as a special situation, which in this case, and in fact, the application, the functional I have is just to define a probability, which is take a supremum. Okay, so in fact, we can prove that this P theta can be chosen as singular probability, which is singular from each other. This gives us a big advantage, which I will come back later. This advantage. So in some sense, it's this kind of thing. It gives us a new framework, which is we can think about Brownian motion. Because in this language, we still have the stability, the same stability. So this does not depend on H. So we still have this stability. We also still have E phi BT 1 BTN BTK B T plus H minus B T is the same thing. I first calculate this, and taking this as constant, and then after this, I calculate backward. So this is the so-called the increment is independent of the things later. So this is have independent increments, and it has I can define this as a Brownian motion under nonlinear expectation. We will come back first to say that in fact with this E, I can define a norm. With this sublinear expectation E, I can define a norm on this space, and then I can take a completion. This is a big advantage after this. So I can take a completion with this and to which, and I should say that this norm is stronger than the relative norm in of Wiener. Wiener to measure. Wiener measures norm is smaller than this one, and is essentially smaller. I think, and then the completion of this LP is a little smaller than the Wiener LP space of norm. Okay, and then I can also define for the processes given like finite dimensional processes, I can also define the supremum norm for this process, and I can also this define the mean the p moment of and the p moment inside and p moment outside. In fact, the most interesting thing here is I can define something which is similar like the Sobolev norm. So the Sobolev norm, this is the first order Sobolev norm in X. This is the in T, and this is in square root of T. So we can define this norm, and so in this way, it corresponds kind of Sobolev norm, and with this Sobolev norm, we can characterize the so-called E-dose formula, E-dose process. We can so, for example, we can define under this norm, we can define E-dose integral beginning from a sample situation, and we can take extension just like the classical situation. And also we can introduce this quadratic variation process. And this quadratic variation process, in fact, is not equal to T. In this case, it's still considered like a Brownian motion, which is the definition is the same, but with only Wiener norm is equal to T, but our norm is stronger, so we can see more. We can see more about many situations. And so this is still like Brownian motion, like but this kind of a Brownian motion is just working like this. So it's independent. The increment is independent from the most recent one, but we can also define the integral with respect to this quadratic process. In fact, the definition is exactly the same. We began from sample functions of then we can define just like Edo, we can define Edo's integral, and we can also define this this one for the case for everything is finitely dimensional. And then we can pass to the limit by using the norm we just introduced. Then after passing to the limit, we have EDOS process, which has DS part. Of DS part, I don't need to see, but because it's easy to define. And we have DB part, and we have, sorry, there is D. Okay, we have D, B, S part. We have three part. We have three part, and the classical EDOS formula have two part, and here we have three part. Why? Because in classical situation, DB is DS. This is DS. But here we can see that we use a strong norm and to see that in fact it's not zero. This part is not zero. It also gives us an important advantage after this. So we can use this nonlinear expectation and the norm introduced by this nonlinear expectation to have the EDOS formula. This EDOS formula also is the classical EDOS process, is also the classical EDOS process. So it is the same process, but we divided by three part. We just divided this by three part. If you use P, you use Wiener norm. So it's you use Wiener norm, it's still EDOS process. Just this one is put in this one. That's the only difference between the two. And we have this is given by Yong Sen Shong 2 years ago, telling us that if this equal to zero, if this identically equal to zero, then this one equal to zero, it's not a surprise. This one equal to zero, this one equal to zero, each part equal to zero. So this gives us an important advantage to distinguish three part. And in fact, this three part is important. These three part have a derivative formulation, have formulation of derivative. So in fact, we can prove, this can be proved very similar, like classically, that if I have UT, BT, which is, then I can have this EDOS formula, but for three part, DS part, DX part, but here, this two part does not merge together. So we have three part. We have three part, and then we pass to, we just use our UT omega, which is in 1, 2, FD, 0, T, just like we defined, we just use this to applying this EDOS formula, then we have this, which is pathwise dependent, which is, so it's not depends on states, it depends on whole space. So this EDOS formula is the EDOS formula for functional. For function of path. It's not just for function. It's for function of the path. And for this, just because we have this proportion. First is U is in this, the process of U is in this sublift space with P bigger than one, with P bigger than one. The secondly, U is EDO processes, which is written, that means that they exist alpha, beta, and alpha, gamma, and beta, such that this U is just written in four parts. The initial value, this part, DB part, and the D quadratic variation, this D, sorry, it's D quadratic variation part. Moreover, just once I can write this EDOS formula, I know that, in fact, according our definition, this part is this, okay? So this part is the derivative by time of u. And this part is derivative, first order derivative by space of u. And this part is second order. This part is second order derivative by this. And so once we have a process, we can write this EDOS process to know immediately what is the first part, what first order time derivative, space derivative. So this is the proposition which gave us. And this result depends on this proposition, which is telling us that this norm is closable. This is closable. And then we have three examples. The first example is if we give any omega alpha, given any omega and take this formula. In this case, the derivative of u with respect to t is omega. And the derivative of u with respect to x equal to zero, and the second order derivative is also equal to zero. So once I have this process, I know this. I know the derivative. I can see the derivative. And also, if I have ut omega, which is beta dbs, which is EDOS integral, in this case, the dtu equal to zero, and the dxu equal to beta, and the square root, the second order identically equal to zero. It's just by I use the things to clearly distinguish everything, okay? So this means that, for example, if I put beta st is the Brownian motion, okay? In this case, I know that dx beta equal to 1. It's just because of this EDO process. This is just the EDO process. I know that this is just by dB part. So it's equal to 1. And that means that in general, the dxx is not equal to the second order. But at the beginning, when we define at finite dimensional space is the same. But when you pass limit, it's no more the same. It's no more the same. Okay. The third example is that I just put ut omega equals to quadratic variation of b. In this case, dtu equal to zero, dxu equal to zero, and this. But the dx, the second order equal to 2. This is also according the EDOS formula. Because I know I write this as EDOS formula, and then I know the situation. Okay, let us. What happened to what case? You mean zero t, zero s, d b s, d b t, okay? Sorry? With f s t, d b s, d b t. This is capital T. This is the, no, the, sorry. This is the S1 T, SS1, like this. So in this case, if you write ut omega equal to this, then I know that dtu equal to zero, because you just have this and the dx ut omega equals zero t f s s d b s, and then but the d square xx ut omega equal to zero, because you have no dbs part, you have no this part, so it's equal to zero. And but if you take dxu, which equal to fss. Yeah, I can also, we can also use to define all such kind of thing, okay. But the strange thing is that at the beginning of definition is correct. The thing is dx is this thing. But when you pass limit, it's normal, it becomes normal, the simulation, okay. So then after this, we can think about if we can define stochastic differential equation as PDE. We can characterize stochastic differential equation as PDE. Yes, because the stochastic differential equation, it can be written like here. We have B, we are given, for example, Lipschitz B, Lipschitz sigma, Lipschitz kappa, Lipschitz kappa, which is defined like this. And if you see this by Wiener measure, so this part merges to this part. But I see it by this nonlinear expectation, and then they have three parts. I can clearly see this three part. And then after this, we can have, we just assume that they have, they are all Lipschitz, then the existence is unique of X, solution of X. It's just this result also includes the classical result as a special case. And also, we know that consequently, if I define this ut omega as a function of path, in fact, it's a function of path. Okay, I define it as function of path, then, of course, it's because it's written like a three part, and it is in this subleaf space. It is this in this subleaf space, and in fact, it is the unique solution, because the uniqueness is proved by uniqueness of this equation. So it is the unique solution of this three equation. So du part equal to b, dx part, dxu part is equal to sigma of u, it's a nonlinear equation. It's nonlinear. And this, the second order is 2 kappa ut omega. And it's unique with, provided that we give this one number. You just give one number, then the equation becomes unique. It's very strange. Till now, we cannot really fully understood this, but it's true. But it's proved. Okay, it's proved that in fact, if you can, you can define this as a PDE. It can be defined as PDE, and the PDE satisfies this equation. And also, I should say that in this case, it's non-trivially path dependent. It's not time dependent. It's not state dependent. So I mean, in very rare situation, you can write xt omega like xt bt. Okay, this is a very, very rare situation. In most situation, is path dependent, and this path satisfy this PDE. Okay. No, no. I will come back to Wiener mesh later. So of course this formulation works in Wiener mesh, but with Wiener mesh, many probability singular from each other you cannot see. This is G. I write G. If I write P, then this is a Wiener. This means you use Wiener. I write G, it means you use a package of P. I define the P theta, OK. Yeah. So this space also is a subset of space of P. Okay? Because it is stronger.
I will come back to this situation.
So this is the SDE we can see from this partial different point of view. And also we can see backward SDE. Backward SDE is not like SDE in the case of G-Brown motion. The backward SDE is to solve three altogether to solve y, z, and eta. Three unknown processes. So this K I just write by for this situation. So you have y, z, e, eta, and which is in this situation. And the backward SDE, the problem of backward SDE is to find a triple, to giving this, and of course giving function f, giving this, and to find the triple of processes y, z, eta, such that this is satisfied. So of course, this equation have not completely solved this equation. We just can, for the moment, solve the case without eta here. And also, we need to I will mention this laterly. But here, we have a theorem, if we, the two things is equivalent. First is we can solve this equation, the equation in this space, in the space of this LP and Superman space. The second is that y, the solution of y, which can be represented as ut omega, which is fully nonlinear PDE of this one. Okay, so which is fully nonlinear PDE by written in this form. So this two is equivalent, but we only establish equivalence. So if there is a unique solution for BSDE, there is a unique solution for this one. And vice versa. And also we know that in fact this y is u. This z is the space derivative. Eta is the second order. So it's just because we write this PDE here part is this db. So this the first order time space derivative. And this part is the second order space-time derivatives. And also we can, but for the moment, what we can do is to prove this, the BSDE of this form. This, for this, if we establish a weaker solution, a weaker, weaker Sobolev norm then we can prove the existence, a uniqueness of this PDE by the recent result obtained by the recent result of this. So we can give the equivalence of this one and this equation and this equation, and we can prove the existence of uniqueness. So this part is already done. And then if the existence uniqueness is proved by Mingshan Hu, Shaolin Ji, and Song, and myself. So after this, we will come back to the situation where you have GA is linear, is a linear situation. This situation, like I mentioned, which is the Wiener process, okay? Which Wiener process? So this equation becomes this equation. So heat equation. Sorry? So this is linear case, yeah. The linear, I will mention later the backward, what is the backward SD, I will mention later. And in this case, becomes EP, P is a Wiener measure, okay, P is a Wiener measure. And so this becomes only one, a singleton. This becomes only singleton where P is a Wiener measure, and the BT, the quadratic process become 2T. So that means you just use this Wiener measure, you cannot distinguish this 2-1. This 2-1 become the same. It's just because it's you have no strong measure to see about this. And SDE, the SDE, now this becomes DT. So this becomes DT. So P almost surely we have dx equals this two together and this sigma x. We only have two, okay? DT and DB. And the corresponding PDE becomes this one plus this one equal to this one, which is the conclusion, which can be concluded by using the premiers. Where premiers, you just put them this equal to this, you put them together, okay? And you have this one, and which is more likely as parabolic PDE situation. And in condition, we have this one, okay? So you have this two, with this two, the solution exists and unique in the sense of P almost surely, and also provided given this constant x0. So this is the situation. And the BSDE becomes what? Just because this k, see this k, because this is become ds. And this becomes 1 over 2. OK, so this two part equal to 0. It becomes to 0, and this part becomes to 0. So this is a classical BSDE. This is classical BSDE. And then we have the classical BSDE have this solution, have a unique solution. This is already long time ago, this given this existence and uniqueness. And also, we have the corresponding path dependence PDE. Each BSDE is a path dependent PDE. Okay? So this is a long time ago, we want to prove this, but now we realize this, that each PDE, time dependent, or so this is generalization of the Feynman-Kac formula we have given just for Markov keys, okay, for Markov key situation. And this WP just have this one and this one put together. I think I have very limited time to give you the correspondence between probability space and nonlinear expectation space. You have almost all things you have a linear correspondent, almost all the things, but with language of QC, the capacity quasi-Shorley analysis. Okay, thank you.